And we're back. Two Hotheads Where Activism Happens on Unregular Radio. And we have our first guest, Cheryl Schumann, is on the phone, who, as Mike already said, runs the Beverly Hills Cannabis Club, was a founding member, or perhaps the founding member, of the Normal Women's Alliance, and also does a lot of work in Hollywood and on TV sets, and is working on a bunch of new stuff now. So we're really happy to have her on the show. Welcome, Cheryl.
Thank you, Heather. And I hear you're the best white girl rapper on the planet. Is that true?
Who did you hear this from?
Oh, everybody was talking about it. The minute I heard that I was going to be on the show, I started getting these calls, and they said you've got to get her to rap.
Oh my goodness!
We're going to have to do that. That's a challenge.
Nobody
love that.
Nobody told me this shit.
You know the thing too, Cheryl. You just hit on a good thing. We should bring up that. Heather is we've just found out Heather's performing at the Boston Freedom Rally.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, my God, that's fantastic. Congratulations.
Thank you very much. Are you going to come out for that, too? That's a little bit far, far away, but I don't know. I mean, it's quite an adventure out here.
I have to tell you guys a secret, Heather, and I spoke to Mike yesterday. I'm actually a huge fan of you guys. I have been dying to attend the Boston Freedom Rally, and to be honest with you, believe it or not, I was too shy to call you guys.
Oh, my goodness. It is so good to have you, then. This is even better. Well, we'll make sure you're not shy. If I'm going to rap, then you are, too, Cheryl.
Yeah.
Beverly Hills Cannabis Club rap.
Oh my goodness. God.
This is
going to
be gangsta.
Right. Okay.
Is gangsta. I'm going to
work on this.
I think that would be one of the last things people would expect.
I think that's true.
I wanted to tell you guys, and I spoke to Mike a bit yesterday. I've been a huge fan of both of you for a long, long time now. I really admire your work. And one of the things that I really impress upon people each time I speak to them is, you know, it's great to be in the cannabis business. It's great to be a cannabis patient. But the bottom line is, without activists, none of this would exist. So when I see people like you guys are out there constantly active, constantly getting people involved and engaged in changing laws and being agents for true social change, that is an admirable quality, and I tip my hat to you.
Oh, my goodness. Thank you so much, Cheryl. We're supposed to be gushing all over you, but you're part of this, clearly.
And that's why we have you on the
show. And that's why we have you here. You're part of this community, and you've been blazing your own trail, so to speak, for quite some time. I know you got started in the entertainment industry and then sort of moved into drug law reform. I'm wondering, how did those things intersect, and how did you get to where you are now?
Sure. You know, basically, I started working as a model and working in television back when I was 17 years old. I was literally the youngest syndicated journalist in the country at age 17 for a show called PM Magazine that was syndicated through Group W Productions. And I was, believe it or not, I was born and raised in Appalachia. We were really, really poor. And just as a basic matter of survival, I learned how to collect packaging from groceries and whatnot, and I formed this couponing and refunding system, and I was helping this little old lady one day, gave her some coupons to go to the market, a reporter was there, and we bought $168 worth of groceries for 16 cents, and I was drafted by this show, and I became America's Coupon Queen at age 17, and was syndicated nationally with them for 3.5 years. And, you know, when you're from a small town and you grew up poor, your family tells you you should always have something to fall back on just to be safe. So I served an apprenticeship as an optician all the way back in 1978, which tells you a little bit about how old I am. But, so, you know, that's when I first learned about cannabis, all the way back in the late 70s. You know, working as a licensed optician, I knew that it helped glaucoma patients and whatnot. So I knew a little bit about it. And then in 1984, I was in a really bad car accident and went through the windshield of a car and was off the air for a while. And that's when I decided to move to California and get a fresh start. And when I got out there, I had my license in optics. And I got this silly little job for $5 an hour at an optical shop in Encino, and one day, lo and behold, Michael Jackson came in
oh
disguise.
Oh, my God.
And, you know, where I grew up, we were, you know, it's so funny. I think because he was in disguise, a lot of people were going like, oh, some black guy in this ritzy neighborhood, blah, 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 and they discriminated against him. And I was brought up in a way to treat everyone with kindness and dignity and honor, and I walked over to him and I said, you know, if I can help you, I'm more than happy to. And then that's when I realized who it was. And I said, I can make a house call for you. You know, if people are bothering you, so you don't have to be in disguise. And he listened to me and he said, would you do that for me? And I'm like, yeah. So
wow.
I went over to his house on Hazeltine Avenue at the time and met his family. And I ended up spending 4 hours with him. And I became Michael Jackson's personal optician. And while we were sitting there, wow. He said, you know, would you mind? I told him my story. I told him about the car accident and everything, moving out here and starting fresh. And he said, you know, very innocently, he said, you know, would you mind if I sent some of my friends to you? And he wow. did. And within 3 weeks, I made $14,000. I met with George Lucas and John Landis and Elton John and Quincy Jones and just all of these amazing
goodness.
Celebrities. And I started making house calls for film and television. And then... after that, I worked on a lot of big films, you know, When Harry Met Sally, Thelma and Louise, Terminator, and I ended up doing...
did you do the Terminator sunglasses?
Pardon?
I was saying, did you do the Terminator sunglasses in that movie?
Oh, gosh, that was one of my biggest hits.
Oh, my goodness.
I work really hard, you guys, but I have to say it's a combination of luck meets opportunity meets preparation. And mm-hmm. at the time, I remember one of the first times I made a house call to a film set, and the director said, oh, my God, this is so cool. I can't believe that someone does this. And I looked at him. I said, you mean no one else does this? And it was like, ding, ding, ding. A light went off in my hand. And I'm like, I'm going to start making house calls. I'm quitting my job. And I ended up building that into a $20 million company by 1993 had my own show on QVC. And what we did is we started specializing in hand props and things that were fashion-driven and lifestyle-driven for film and television. And over a 25-year career, I ended up working on over 3,000 motion pictures and feature films and TV shows and music videos. And I ended up getting my own show on QVC and doing regular segments on Access Hollywood and Entertainment Tonight. And I became known as a product placement expert and the optician to the stars. So I was able to build that brand, and it was called Starry Eyes. And then everything went really great. I had a very long, successful career, and life was good. And then one day I woke up and found myself diagnosed with ovarian cancer. And when I was diagnosed, I was rushed to the emergency room and emergency surgery. I ended up going through cancer treatment for almost 4 years, 7 surgeries. And I got into the cannabis world, if you will, basically as a last resort. Mm-hmm. I was hooked up to intravenous morphine pumps, 27 different pharmaceuticals to treat the pain, and literally was for all intents and purposes a vegetable. I couldn't go to the bathroom by myself. I couldn't wash my hair by myself. I was fed through tubes and IVs, and it was just no quality of life. And that's when I started learning about cannabis. And although I knew it was good for glaucoma and such, I had heard, you know, like a lot of people, that, you know, some cancer patients used it through chemo and whatnot. But then I heard about the Rick Simpson story, and I met Dr. Bob Malamede with Cannabis Science, and I met Dr. Janet Sweeney with the Rick Simpson Foundation and the Phoenix Tears Foundation. And I spent, a month with them going through treatment. And in a nutshell, I learned how to use and make the cannabis oil. I started my own cannabis garden, formed a legal collective, a gardening collective under the State Attorney General guidelines in California, so I would be legal. And I went on a nutrition and health spiritual journey, if you will. And literally within 90 days, I went from being bedridden and unable to have any quality of life to being able to work full time. And I just felt that, quite frankly, I feel that cannabis has saved my life. And I got really sick and tired of seeing the media portray all of us in this very negative image. And it made me angry, because I don't want my children or my family to say, oh, you know, yeah, my daughter, she's a pothead or something like that, because that's not who we are. I'm a firm believer that the modern cannabis consumer are, quite frankly, a lot of corporate executives, doctors, lawyers, and people just like anyone next door. It could be your teacher, it could be anyone. And the big problem that we face is there's such a negative image and stereotype assigned to the modern cannabis consumer. And I felt that, you know, this is apparently my mission in life, because it saved my life. And I just felt like if I can make a difference by putting a fresh face on it and talking about it and speaking openly, I feel like, you know, perhaps maybe somebody seeing this or hearing this or seeing something I did can say, oh, my God, I would never thought someone like that would use cannabis. And it opens up the dialogue, and it gets people talking. And then what a lot of people find is like, oh, my God, do you use cannabis? Yeah, me too. And right. It becomes this me too philosophy. And then when you see, you know, patients are being denied liver transplants and other organ transplants simply because they're using cannabis and it's still a Schedule I drug, people start listening and they start to take action because people are dying because this miraculous medicine needs to be reclassified. And until we gather all of the people out there who, in the cause that support us, we need to activate them. And that's where becoming an activist is so important.
Yeah, tell
so it. I decided to dedicate my life to being an agent for social change and hopefully reforming cannabis laws throughout the country.
Cheryl, the activism, we had to talk last night, and one of the things that we discussed was what's going on right now with the medical marijuana dispensaries, and in the past how you were one of the people that organized to make sure that certain dispensaries were able to stay open, that there was some amnesty. Tell us what's going on, what happened in the past, and what people can do right now.
Oh, thank you for asking. Yeah, California has been hit incredibly hard by the federal government. When the announcement came down on October 7th of this past year, Obama basically threatened with four attorneys to shut down pretty much every cannabis business in this sector. And so it started with San Jose and San Francisco, and now it's in L.A., but basically, they're trying to shut everyone down. It started with San Jose, and I started working with Senator John Vasconcellos, who was the granddaddy and father of SB 420, which is basically the law in California after 215 that enabled us to use cannabis, you know, responsibly and legally and within, you know, the legal guidelines of California. So the big problem in California right now is we really need regulation of some sort. There have been a lot of rogue operations who open up, and the bad eggs have kind of ruined it for all the good people. There's other issues with the federal government here. I'm sure you've heard about Stephen D'Angelo with Harborside and Richard Lee and a lot of the problems with the 280E rule. And the 280E rule basically states that any cannabis business, you know, we're the only businesses that can't have bank accounts. We can't deduct traditional business expenses like, you know, rent and salaries and insurance and cost of goods. And so they're using these internal revenue laws, 280E, to shut people down, and they're going specifically after high-profile people. I'm sure a lot of you have seen the Richard Lee raids on Oaksterdam, the threats against Steve D'Angelo at Harborside, which has a model dispensary that everyone knows about from the reality series Weed Wars. And then they went into San Jose. And when that happened, basically, we organized a big event called the West Coast Cannabis Expo. I got all of the top activists out to get people engaged and learn, and we started a referendum to save the city of San Jose. And James Anthony and his group with the San Jose organizations, we were able to get a sanctuary agreement where the city council basically agreed to let the good people, the people who were following the rules, stay open while the city ironed it out. And we were able to do the same thing in Long Beach, and now L.A. is facing the same exact problem. L.A. has voted unanimously to shut down every single cannabis dispensary in the city, and they're only going to allow collectives of 3 members or less.
Wow.
And we all know, and we lovingly refer to Los Angeles as the belly of the beast as far as cannabis consumption. We consume more cannabis in the city and county of Los Angeles than anywhere else in the nation. So the thought of all of those dispensaries shutting down and
so that's where all the smog comes
from. It's forcing them to go to the streets. Who knows what could happen out there? They don't know if they're getting clean medicine or good medicine or if they're even going to be robbed when they're doing it. So it's really, really important. The good folks at Americans for Safe Access, Don Duncan, Seth Shear, they've organized a website called Stop the Ban LA. And I think it's .com. Let me check real quick. It is stopthebanla.com. So for any information that anyone wants, if they're in the Los Angeles area or listening to this, they can go there, they can get information, they can download pamphlets and flyers, get people activated. They need to get enough signatures within the next 30 days to organize a referendum and to save the collectives and businesses within Los Angeles. And it's just very, very important. Sitting
yes,
on
absolutely.
Your sofa and not doing anything isn't going to change anything.
And this is the type of activism we're talking about. I mean, actually getting out there and using the skills that you've see, you know, you that you've carried with you through your life of being, you know, not afraid to be a little aggressive and to speak up and to be able to do that in such a positive way and such an applicable way, especially when there's such a chilling effect going on, I think, with medical marijuana, especially in California with all the raids and Oaksterdam going down. And, you know, it takes an extra amount of guts now to be so outspoken about it.
You know, you guys, I was interviewed by CBS the other day, and they asked me, they said, do you ever fear going to jail? Because, quite frankly, they're targeting the highest profile people. So she was interviewing me. I said, you know what? Of course I'm afraid. But you know what? As a cannabis consumer in any state, you have to sign a declaration that you acknowledge that you're breaking federal law. Mm-hmm. So as a cannabis patient anywhere in this country, you could face going to prison at any time. Right. And it's very scary. It's very, very scary. But the bottom line is, as we all know, we have to speak out. And, you know, one of the things that we did in Long Beach, and I was so proud of the community there, is they really jumped in. And what city council and these elected officials need to know, if they want to hold on to their elected office, they have to serve the wishes and the desires of the people who voted for safe access for medical cannabis. So we had T-shirts made and signs made so that every single one, when we held those rallies, there were TV cameras there, and every single seat in that city council was full with T-shirts that said, my vote counts. And they had signs showing which mm-hmm. city councilman was theirs and what district they were in. So they have to know, these are the people. The people are speaking, and they want to keep safe access to their medicine. So, you know, the funny thing is, you know, I don't know, Michael, maybe you guys can tell me about this. The funny thing about being a female activist, and this was one of the reasons
this is a question I was going to ask.
Sabrina Fendrick, you know, when you're quote-unquote assertive or mm-hmm. strong as a woman, you get labeled as a, you know what?
If you're
man, you're just, you know, you're out there.
You're just being,
and, you know, when I first got into the activism movement, I have to tell you, it wasn't easy. And there were people, especially the prohibitionists, who want to target you and call you names. And, you know, they're really mean. They're mean. So, you know, what I have to say to people is, you know, believe in what we're doing. What we're doing, we're on the right side of this. And
absolutely.
We need to be proud of who we are, because we're showing dignity and courage and strength and integrity. We need to hold our heads up high and be proud of the fact that we're legal medical cannabis consumers. And hopefully someday in some areas we can be legal cannabis recreational consumers for those who prefer to have cannabis over alcohol,
exactly.
Which, quite frankly, cannabis is much more healthy than alcohol.
Yeah. Exactly.
So, you know, we're right at that tipping point, you guys. And
yes.
And that's why, you know, with the work that I do, I specialize in film, television, product placement, celebrity media relations, and I'm a firm believer in doing work with people like Tommy Chong and mm-hmm. on the Wilford Show and doing different TV and film projects, that we can open up a dialogue, get the subject of conversation on the dinner tables and at the water coolers, and mm-hmm. that's how you become an agent for change.
Exactly.
And that's what we need more
right on.
Yeah, right
well
on,
said.
Right on.
I actually, you brought up in that wonderful little speech right there that the fact about the facet of being a woman activist, specifically in drug reform, but really in all forms of activism, and you were instrumental in starting the Normal Women's Alliance, and I would like to know about that. I personally have done, you know, activism for a very long time, and it is rare to see female leaders of, you know, of local organizations, of local normals and mass cans and stuff like that.
Let me fill you in on that. I actually started, Russ Belville, he kind of discovered me in the Normal Network, and at the time, my daughter and I were attending a lot of normal functions and activism functions, not as a leader, but out of curiosity and wanting to seek out knowledge and seek out and get to know the leaders in this community and become more active. But Russ Belville is actually the one that found me, and he invited me to be the executive director for Beverly Hills Normal.
He's a good dude.
And so while I was the executive for Beverly Hills Normal, we had a big, big event with Cheech and Chong that went amazingly well. But one of the things that I found was that as a woman, I was targeted, and I got a lot of hate mail and so forth. And the idea actually sprang from Sabrina Fendrick, who was Alan St. Pierre's, and who still is Alan St. Pierre's assistant. And Sabrina and I, we used to have almost a mother-daughter relationship, and we used to speak almost every day, and we spoke daily about the need for women to have a place to go, because this is a very, and I love men, don't get me wrong, Mike, love you too. The problem was, it's a male-dominated society, and it's not always very welcoming, the old boys' club, to women. And so Sabrina and Ann Davis, who's with New Jersey Normal, and a lot of the other women, Madeline Martinez and so forth, we all got together, and there was a steering committee formed of the founding members for the Normal Women's Alliance. And we all got together, and we were in Washington, D.C., and we set up the direction to take the Normal Women's Alliance. And I have to give my hat to Sabrina, because she really is the person in the Washington, D.C. office who works every single day and is so dedicated to this cause. I'm not that active with the Normal Women's Alliance right now, although I support them and I love them and I'm happy to help them raise money and everything. But really, the credit right now goes to Sabrina Fendrick. Right. She's working her tush off to get out there. She and Stacia Costner from SSDP started an amazing sister-to-sister program, which provides mentorship for some of the older or more mature, seasoned activists with the younger girls.
That's awesome.
I have a wonderful little sister that I've mentored and kind of sort of adopted into the movement.
That's amazing. So they're just doing
a great job, and I tip my hat. The Normal Women's Alliance, from that very first little inkling of an idea, has grown and just done such an amazing job, and now I kind of sit from the sidelines, and I'm proud of what we started, and they're taking the ball and running with it, and they're really doing it.
And I thank you for it, definitely, and I'm sure, and everybody, men and women, can thank you for it.
And if anyone is calling you a bitch, that's just because you're too effective.
UNITY.
Because, like, seriously, it's jealousy. I got to say it, because we need that. We need the women out there, and we need the ones like
yourself.
And the
men need the women out there. I mean, that's why I'm saying men and women alike can support that and say that it's not sanctioning yourself off. It's saying that we're supporting women activists and giving them a chance. Because I remember being at meetings, not being specific, where I really felt like if I didn't scream or shout or get up on a table, then I was never going to be heard. And, but that didn't last long, because now I get to
hold you.
I know. Here I am every week. Yeah. But it was a lot. It was a lot of struggling at the beginning.
You have to turn her mic down.
Oh, shut up. Whatever. No, see, Cheryl's on my side. Oh, we're good.
Yeah.
We're starting our own alliance right now.
I have to add a little bit, because in support of women everywhere, there are actually a couple of different women's organizations. There's Moms for Marijuana, directed by Sarah Frank, who's a lovely, lovely young woman. I just love her to pieces. I have such tremendous admiration and respect. There's the Women's Marijuana Movement that Jessica Corey is very involved with, and Mason DeVert, and they do a lot of great work for women. So there's actually several, from that initial Normal Women's Alliance, there have actually been several branches off. And what I really like to see is, I support all women, not just one group. I support all the groups. I support all of the activism groups. I know when we produced PushCon, I thought it was very, very important. I called it the United Nations of cannabis law reform, because we have leaders from everywhere, from DPA, MPP, Americans for Safe Access, Normal Women's Alliance, Moms for Marijuana, you name it, and they were there. And I feel like, you got guys, the bottom line is, we have enough against us dealing with the prohibitionists and the crazy right-wingers and the people who want to see us go down. If we don't all get together and all support all of us in this movement, we won't have a movement anymore. And you know what? It's still a movement. It's still a movement. It's very much a movement. And we need unity in this community now more than ever.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Thank you, Cheryl.
That's absolutely true. We see it all the time, all the factions that take down movements and have threatened to take down, us, and what we do. So
it happens a lot.
Absolutely. And what's the very biggest problem that I've seen in the activism community, quite frankly, is money and funding.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. It's so difficult. This economy, people are losing their homes, so it's very, very difficult. So, I urge everyone, you may not like what somebody wears or how they comb their hair or how they speak or whatever, but the bottom line, guys, is as activists, we're all brothers and sisters, and we're all members of one big family trying to make a difference in this world. You know, that's the bottom line, and we've got to stick together. And I'll go to my grave with that one.
Absolutely, I'm gonna keep applauding for you. I'm on your side.
Look, he's mad.
Have you guys seen the Tommy Chong video yet?
Yes, we have. I've seen it. That was a great video. Yeah, everyone should check it out. Where did they find it?
Well, if you can go to Beverly Hills Cannabis on YouTube, or go to CherylSchumann.com, and you can keep up to date with everything that I'm doing, or BeverlyHillsCannabisClub.com. But as you guys know, Tommy recently announced he had prostate cancer back on June 10th with CNN. And the minute I found out, you know, I've known Tommy for over 20 years. We actually had the same publicist back when he was working with That 70s Show. And Cheech and Chong were both very instrumental in helping us launch Beverly Hills Normal. And he's always, you know, he's just such an amazing sweetheart of a guy. So I did this really wonderful interview with him, because a lot of times I'm always disappointed when I only see like a minute and a half of something on CNN. Great story, but like, right. I want the meat of it. I want to know more. So we did a full hour-long interview with Tommy, going over his entire career and finishing with cannabis. And I gave him, you know, you guys, I'm working for this product called the Canisig. Have you heard of it?
Yes.
It's a new vaporizer, and it's specifically made for the cannabis oil. So I took him over to Rick Simpson Oil, and he's working with Rick Simpson directly now, and Dr. Janet Sweeney at the Phoenix Cures Foundation. And if you look at the video, I show him how to use it and everything, and then about 6 weeks later, he tweeted that 99% of his cancer on his test is now gone.
Wow,
so for
those
naysayers,
that's,
you know,
pretty unbelievable.
I mean, it's phenomenal, and he's looking great and looking fabulous. So check out that
whatever
video.
We have to celebrate that. That's fantastic.
And then coming up next week and the week after, there's the Wilfred episodes that I've worked on. This is my second season as the marijuana expert on Wilfred.
Wow.
And we redecorated the entire collective scene.
Wow.
And it's just really cool. I'm very proud of it. And I love the show. It's a great, great show. I think you guys will like it.
Yeah, I've seen this show. Yeah, I've watched the show. Yeah.
FX, Wilfred. Some big stars in the show. Are they
Elijah
nice people?
Wood.
Elijah Wood, how's he? Is he a nice guy? Does he smoke up?
You want to know something? Really one of the nicest guys I've ever met. My friends are the casting director and the executive producer of the show. So when I go there, it's truly like being part of a family. And, you know, Elijah Wood is one of the main stars. Jason Gann is the dog, Wilfred. Mm-hmm. And first of all, Jason is a very dirty dog, I have to tell you. And you know what, Elijah, one of the things I really like about Elijah and Jason and the other stars, whether it be Robin Williams or Steve Weber or a lot of the other Fiona Gumbelman, what I really like about them is they're so down to earth. And, you know, there's a separation in the entertainment world referred to. There's the above the line, there's the talent, there's the suits. And as a general rule, none of them mix because they're different socioeconomic classes and whatnot. But what I like about Wilfred and the family atmosphere is Elijah was one of the first people to say, hey, come down and sit down and have lunch with us. And we were all sitting down together, and he's just so down to earth. And I, of course, I'm biased because he said one of his favorite people was his mom, you know? I'm thinking, oh my God, I love you already.
Yeah.
And he's just a sweetheart. And then Jason, I have to, it's a funny little story. Jason was kind of flirting with me the first day that we met, you know, and he was in the dog suit, and my daughter wanted to meet Elijah, so I brought her on the set, and my daughter looked at Jason, she goes, seriously, dude, you're in a dog suit, okay?
You have to admire.
I don't blame him.
The tenacity of someone that's willing to do that in a dog suit.
Good for him.
He's a sweetheart. We've actually become pretty good friends. We've hung out a couple of times and gone to a couple of events together, and he's just a sweetheart. And I have to tell you, actually, quite the ladies' man. I've never seen so many beautiful women hanging around a guy, and he's in the dog suit. Jason is like that cute little puppy dog at the park. You know, that's the chick magnet for. Yeah. You know, that's what Jason is. He's that in real life.
But he's in a dog costume too. That's pretty meta.
Yeah.
That's.
and you know, the other great thing about Wilfred is, you know, number one, it's great, it's funny, it's really cutting edge. But because it's become such a hit, everybody's talking about marijuana. Everybody's talking about marijuana and cannabis. And one of the things I'm most excited about, you know, and rebuilding the collective scene is I'm able, because, you know, they call me the Martha Stewart of marijuana, you know, because I'm all about products. And with my QVC background and television background, my dream one day is to have a shopping channel all of cannabis products.
Oh, I mean, my gosh. I like that QVC, a CVC or yeah, something like
no
that.
No one's going to stop you. You could tell you're getting there already.
Or, like, or CNN, Cannabis News Network.
Oh, I like this. Yeah. Oh, you've clearly already made these connections. I love it.
So what I like, when I went over and have done these sets the past couple of years, they're really shocked, truly, at the level of quality and the packaging of these products. And how many different products there are. We had literally over 20 different vaporizers on the set, all of these beautiful gourmet edibles and chocolates and just really stunning. And you know, it makes my heart proud when people say, oh my God, this is absolutely gorgeous. And what was even more funny, because a lot of the crew members are also legal cannabis consumers, they're like, oh my God, I feel like I want to whip out my card and buy something.
That is awesome. We'll have to check this out. When does it air? When is the... When does it show on TV?
It's either going to be next Thursday or the Thursday after. They won't tell me exactly what scene it is, and I can't tell you what's in the scene. But okay. I can tell you one thing. It's a damn good-looking collective, because it's the Beverly Hills Cannabis Club recreated for television.
Oh, my goodness. That's amazing.
So I'm very proud, you know?
You should be.
I can't give away any set secrets, but I can tell you it's going to have all the latest products in it, and I can tell you that, as always, Wilfred is always into trouble and always trying to get Elijah, his character, into trouble. So it's going to be a fun episode, and I highly recommend it. And what I tell people is watch them all, and that way you'll definitely catch it, but I know it's coming up in the next week or two.
Oh, that's awesome. Definitely be tuning in, and I know we have to wrap things up, so to honor my previous commitment, I wrote you a rap.
Oh, yeah.
Over the course of the show.
I have a little shout out to someone. Is that okay?
Yeah, absolutely.
I want to send out a little shout out to my RFMK people and all of the investors that invest in this product. And, you know, we're the only publicly traded company that actually has a product with a vaporizer. And the other thing I love about this company, they support me, number one, and they actually allow me to do my activism work. And they're very supportive of the activism community. So they get it. And
I love
a lot
that.
Of those companies
that
don't.
Is so,
so
important.
I want to give a shout out and a thank you to all those guys that support us out there. And it's a great product. So if you need a really great vaporizer, get a Canisig and look at RFMK as an investment, because they're really a great company. I'm very, very proud to work with them. So shout out to all you guys. Holler. Oh, and I have to shout out to Marlon Wayans and my friend Steve Harris from A&E. Oh, the reality series. Guys, we have 4 reality series in development with William Morris Endeavor.
Oh my goodness! Is this official yet? Tell us a little bit about it. That sounds awesome.
This is awesome. Back in October, right when big federal raids came down, I always was getting calls from different producers and whatnot, saying, you know, because there's a lot of producers in LA, right? And they're like, hey, we've been following your career, blah blah blah. We want to do a reality series with you. And this one day, it came in the same week of all the federal raids, and I said, you brought up, with all due respect, I'm knee deep in organizing press conferences, getting all this done, and I said, unless you can tell me something different than all of these other aspiring producers, I really just don't have time right now because the community needs me. And he said the magic words. He said, how about this? I'm Steve Harris. I'm the development executive at the A&E Network, the Greenlight series. And I'm like, okay, I'm listening. So Steve Harris and I have become very good friends, and he's formed a production company with Marlon Wayans, and we have a couple of different reality series in development, and there's 4 in total, and I'm working with a number of other production companies, but these 4 are all going to be about women in cannabis.
Ah, I like this.
And you have to stay tuned, because we start filming. We have already started a talent search and a casting to gather people's interesting stories and put them down. We just filmed a huge CBS feature 2-part series about women who are moms with cannabis, who prefer to use cannabis over alcohol. And that's going to be airing in September. Plus, I'm going to be speaking at Seattle Hemp Fest this weekend.
Right,
the big show, and Champs, and the National Cannabis Industry Association in November, and the Normal Conference. Don't forget that.
Can we get A&E in the studio here and film some of our our show with you? Can
we? We want to get you at the Freedom Rally.
Can we get
at
you
least
down here? We want Cheryl Schumann in Boston.
I would love that. Truly, you guys. I mean, this series basically it's kind of like a combination of Entourage and Beverly Hills Housewives.
Ganjaraj. Sorry.
And you want to know the other great thing about this? And Steve and I both talked, and I said, look, I want ownership and control. So we've divided the ownership. I have part ownership of the show, and I'm also one of the executive producers of the show. And one of the things I really love about working with these guys is they're listening. So instead of doing some silly, crazy, goofball marijuana reality series, activism is going to be a huge part of it. And I want the people who are true activists and not just hamming it up for the camera. I want the real people behind the scenes who are the real leaders, the real community organizers. And, of course, that'll be mixed in with the Justin Timberlakes and the Black Eyed Peas and the Cameron Diazes.
Oh, damn.
The best of celebrity culture and the best of cannabis culture.
That's awesome.
So I think it's going to be great, and I'm really looking forward to it. And I would love to have you guys be a part of it.
My goodness. That would be such an honor and a privilege. I can't even begin to wrap my mind around that. That's incredible. I'm so glad that it's someone like you that's doing this. I got to do it.
Steve, the guy from A&E is listening. This is everything's right, on the line right today for our show.
All right.
Our activism.
No pressure here. All right, whatever. All right, this one is for you, Cheryl. This one's for you.
Thank you.
All right. So fresh to death in my Schumann specs, dressed to impress on the TV set, smoke some sessies, the stress, keep my blood pressure in check. I'm precious, straight, effortless, best give respect to the women activists from East Coast to West, two hotheads with Cheryl, inhale and get blessed.
Yeah!
I love it! I love it! I can see that opening show on the reality series. What do you think about that?
Oh, hell yeah. That was just me scribbling during the show. That was like
usually we make it easier for him, put a beep on.
Oh, man.
We really put the pressure on Heather today.
Well, I was inspired.
That was fantastic. I'm honored, truly. Thank you so much.
Oh, thank you.
I can't wait to see you guys in person.
Oh, let's make it happen. Absolutely.
Yeah. And thank you so much for being on the show today, Cheryl.
Absolutely.
Had a blast.
And anytime I can be a guest, I would love it and be honored and, you know, keep you updated on the West Coast stuff, and God bless you, and keep doing the great work that
awesome
you do.
Awesome.
Oh, you're the best. You're the best, Cheryl. Thank you so much for being on the show. It's truly our pleasure, and it's wonderful. All the wonderful things that are coming your way, you've clearly brought to you, and you deserve every one of them. So thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Have a great weekend, guys.
You too.
Bye.
Wow, that was great.
Bye-bye.
That was a good, she's getting it done.
That's amazing.
She's killing it.
It's that personality. You can tell it over the phone,
You know how our show goes, too. It's if they vibe off of us, we know we're good. Like, right away. I knew this was going to be good, didn't you?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Now I'm going to have to write raps for every guest, though, Mike.
No, only the special ones.
It's true.
That was like, you know, you did the thing with C-Money that day. That was C-Special. C-Money from Slightly Stupid. And not just because he's in Slightly Stupid, which is a huge act, but just the way he was that day.
It's true.
And same with Cheryl. It's more about just that person. I don't know what it is, but you can feel it with her. She's killing it.
Yeah. That was such a blast. And
that was good.
She's clearly an amazing person.
If anyone wants to weigh in too, 617-606-4122. We haven't even given out the phone number. And if@unregularradio.com. We're going to take a musical break, and we're going to come back with another guest. We're going to be finding all about Insane Clown Posse. What is that noise?
I think it was the insane clowns.
Yeah. I think we got some insane clown posses in our headphones.
I think so.
That's what's gonna go on. We're gonna come back. And
yeah. What
do
we got next, Derek?
DJ Slim, Stoner Chick.
Oh, hell yeah!
Another Freedom Rally performer.
There we go. Yeah. Two hotheads.